on day 3, God created living things and land.
Okay, so tell us about what happened with the land, with the sea, with the living things.
This one. Mm-hmm. Now to Abraham and his seed, where the promises made. He does not say, and two seeds, as of me, but as of one, and to you, and to your seed, who is Christ.
Okay. So, from Galatians 3:6, we can see that Jesus was already thought about right from the beginning. So we learned. So also another question to all of you. Does a seed have life inside of it? Aha. They're quite clever, eh? Now we learned, we learned all about this, that a seed has life inside of it. And when we plant the seed in good soil and water it, the seed will grow as it has life, which we see our plants outside have done that. And we also learned that Jesus was called a seed by God to Abraham. In the beginning, Jesus has life, and when he is planted in a heart that has good soil, he will help us to grow in him. Right, then what did we learn for the rocks?
Rafa, you read. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and put them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock.
Yes, okay. Okay, and what will happen if you stand on a rock? That's a question to you, parents. What happens if you stand on a rock? Sorry? You stand firm, yes. So we learn that a rock is solid, tough, and unbreakable. Just that is the same as Jesus. If we stand with Jesus, he is solid and unbreakable. He is reliable to stand on. Okay. So what we've learned and how to cope with worry is to remember who Jesus is. Remember that he created the earth. He is all-knowing. He is light. What is light? Light helps us to see. He will help us see. He is even with us when we can't even see him, just like air. And he is a seed that brings life when we choose him. And he is rock. We can depend on him. So all of those things we need to turn to for Jesus to help us. Okay, we need Daniel and his friend, please. Where's Daniel? Okay, guys, you can sit down now. Okay, Daniel, here we go. You're going to read. You're going to help him. Come.
Oh, wait. Did I just cough? Okay. So, Siva, you start first, okay?
Romans?
Okay. No, I'll keep my mask on. If it's okay with everyone. Well, since the creation of the world, God's invincible. Oh. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities has internal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuses.
Well done. So they were very nervous, but they did read it nicely for us. Okay.
Come, Anna. Come, Cheryl. Come, Imi. So with the group of the little ones, we gave them all these loose parts, and then we asked them to create how they see God. And this is how they created, how they see God in themselves. And I've got some responses. After they created this, I've got some responses to them. I asked them how they see God in creation. And some of them, they say they see God in creation as a person. And some, they say it when they fill their brains, they see God. And some, they say they can feel God in their heart. That's why they made hearts. And then because Jesus is in their heart. And some of them, they say if they see the sun, they feel that is God. And when they see the rainbows, when they see the rainbow up there, then they feel that is God in creation. And the light, most of them, they say it when they feel God, they see God in creation as light, because God is the light and is the Father of everything.
Okay, so that's our main thing, is that we've been learning about seeing God in creation, and we have no excuse. And when we know that the power of God is the one who created what we live in, we know who to turn to when we're worried.
Ooh, guys, well done to the kids. You guys did well. Perfect. Oh, guys, I've just been told there are some pair of gloves, 98 of them, 92, outside. But you can get them after the service. So please, don't play rugby when you want to go grab them. Please, just make a line and, you know. But guys, they're really nice. They keep you warm. Please, help yourself with some. And yes, are the singers going to, you know... Yeah, let's rock this place up, guys. Rock and roll. Okay, let's pray. Father God, I'd like to pray, Lord, for praise, Lord, for praise and worship, Lord. For everybody who's going to be serving, Lord, thank you, Lord, that they're just using their voice, Lord, to you, Lord, to praise you, Lord, because, Lord, you deserve our praise. And it says that when we sing together in unity, incredible things happen. So I pray, Lord, that as we sing, Lord, we just praise you, Lord, and just worship you and just feel something moved in our hearts. Amen.
How great
Thank you, God, for just who you are, Lord, and how great and magnificent you are, Lord. Thank you for just helping us, Lord, just to feel your presence, Lord, and just feel that you're here, Lord. As we sing together, Lord, we just praise you, Lord, because, Lord, you deserve our praise, Lord. You deserve to be worshipped, Lord. Father God, thank you, Lord, for just every single person here, Lord, who's raising their voice, Lord, and just crying to you, Lord, asking for their help, Lord. Father God, you, Lord, can do incredible miracles, Lord. You calm down the roaring sea, the seas, Lord. Lord, there's nothing you can't do, Lord. You are incredible, Lord. I pray, Lord, that can just every person here, Lord, just feel moved, Lord, and just feel that you are here and that they can just always depend on you, Lord. Amen. And Glenn, please come up, man. Oh, guys, the tithes and offerings, boxes. Where are they? Can't seem to find them.
Yes. Just want to check something over here. Okay, so how's everybody this morning? It's great to have. I thought we had one more song in the tank there. I was enjoying it so much, but I wasn't supposed to be up here at all today, but there's one job I've been given or responsibility that's a real privilege, and that's to give some flowers to myself. No, it's to give some flowers to a very special lady in the house who's turning a milestone birthday tomorrow. You don't normally embarrass a lady by saying their age, but I'm quite sure that you're going to join me in celebrating, if we can call Mama Sue Ford. It's her 60th birthday tomorrow morning. Tony and Sue, how long have you been in the church? 18 years. 18 years of serving this body, loving this body, most importantly, and laying down their lives. And so for Sue, this is a significant year. I know she's trusted God for a number of things building up to this year, and we just wanted to honor you today and give you something special. Apparently roses are your favorite, but we could not find them this morning, but these are beautiful. So why don't you join me in just praying a blessing over Sue? Why don't you reach out your hand? Father, we thank you for a heart. This morning in the prayer meeting, it was all about love, that we would love one another, and I think Sue has modeled that, Father. We've seen her do that. Through the ministry she's involved in, but more importantly, just through who she is, that she has a genuine, deep, deep, deep love for people and goes the extra mile for people who are often even just struggling to have hope for themselves, that she would come alongside them. So we thank you. I've felt specifically, Sue, to pray for you for that every desire of your heart would come to fruition. And I know there's some of those, and there's been some tough things that have happened as well in the last while, but we just say, Father, every desire of Sue's heart, we give it to you this morning. We say, won't you bring favor over her life, Lord? Thank you that we get to celebrate a milestone birthday tomorrow, and we bless her today in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Thank you, Sue.
Day to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Sue. Happy birthday to you. Woo!
Cool. She likes the Xhosa version too. Dave, you can go.
Kuwe, ninum nandi kuwe, ninum nandi kuwe, ninum nandi kuwe.
Woo! Isn't this church special? I don't think I've got anything else to do, but I think a few people know what Josh is going to preach on just now. But Patty didn't know what Josh was going to preach on, but her shirt, just stand up quickly to show them everybody. It says, worry ends when faith arrives or when faith begins. So there's a song. Yeah, it's lovely. Beautiful, prophetic shirt for today. Welcome to the whole Austin clan. I see you in the house. Welcome to Sid and Bev. Always good to have Mama and Papa back in the house. Grandparents now, you know, of the house. But I just want to introduce a song that Josh is going to be preaching now soon. But I sent him this song this week when I knew what he was going to preach about. And I said to him, this song ministered to me because God is, he works in peculiar ways. So if you don't like the song or you have an issue with it theologically, you have an issue with me. But it's an incredible song that God spoke to me, and Josh said, I actually like it. I'm going to use it as an intro to my preach this morning. So if we can roll the song, and at some point our preacher will arrive at the pulpit, you can, Diewald and the guys can get, Nathan, you here. Good to see you as well, youngster. Good day. You can help carry the pulpit. Okay. So if the sound guys, and we've got youngsters on, Donnell on DP, we've got guys behind the camera that also Thomas and the guys, so the youngsters are running everything today, but Elvis, I do want my keys back later. I sort of symbolically gave him the keys to the church. I don't know if he intends to give them back to me, but it's fine. Okay, can we play the song?
All right, good morning, everyone. I've never seen people so excited about a song before in church, so maybe we should play those more often. I just want to welcome everyone, especially the visitors. I also want to welcome my family. They are all the way from Port Alfred. My grandparents and uncle are also here today, so thank you for coming to support me. And then I just want to thank Kaya and Glenn and the elders for the opportunity to speak today. I know there's lots of other people that have incredible voices in this church, so thank you for giving me the platform today to speak. All right, I don't know if you've ever read something in the Bible, particularly something that Jesus says, and thought, wow, only you can get away with saying that, Jesus. Like, there's that time, I don't know if you know, if you've read these words of Jesus, where he went up to the pastors of his day, so think like Glenn and Gerald, and he called them snakes. I mean, imagine if I got up here today, and I went up to Glenn and Gerald, you snakes, I think my mic would get switched off. Has kind of been given away already. But I think what Jesus says to us today is something that only really he gets away with saying, right? Don't worry. I don't know if you've ever told someone who's anxious or stressed out not to worry. They don't normally respond very well, at least in my experience. So this is something that only really Jesus gets away with saying, and perhaps we'll see why today as well. So we're going to go in our Bibles to Matthew chapter 6, verse 25 to 34. I think it should come up on the screen as well. And just to remind you, and maybe you haven't been with us or whatnot, but we are in the series as a church called Questions Jesus Asked. So we're looking in the Gospels at the different questions that Jesus has been asking, and we've been seeing what is he trying to get us to learn through those questions. And today's passage of Scripture contains no less than 5 very simple but very powerful questions that Jesus asked. So maybe as you go through, you can track along and see all the questions that Jesus asks in this passage. Right, here we go. Matthew 6, verse 25 to 34. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we wear, what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. So, as I've already mentioned, generally when we tell people not to worry, it doesn't end up so well. And yet Jesus, yeah, three times in this passage, he uses the words, do not worry. And I'm also quite fascinated, like Jesus is not telling us not to worry about trivial things, like whether the Bulls are going to win the URC final. Sorry, Glenn, I know it's been mentioned already. But Jesus is not telling us, ach, don't worry about silly things. He's saying, do not worry about the fundamental needs of life, the things we need to survive, food, water, clothes. Yeah, water, big issue here in our city. So, and, you know, I also, you know, when I was meditating on the scripture, I realized, like, things like food and water and clothes, some of us here are quite privileged. We've never had to wonder where our next meal is coming from. We've always been confident that there's going to be food on the table to eat. But even those of us, and then there are others of us in this room that I think know what it's like to wonder where the next meal is coming from, to not know whether you're going to have enough food to the end of the month. But whatever camp you're in, these are the things, food and water and clothing, our primary needs. These are things that consume our thoughts daily. How much of the time and how much of your energy is spent thinking about what you're going to eat, what you're going to wear, what you're going to drink? Ladies, you can help me out of this. When you wake up in the morning and you open that cupboard, what question do you ask yourself? What am I going to wear? Yeah, in the morning, what am I going to wear? In the evening when we get home, what do we always ask? Ooh, what are we going to eat? These questions consume our daily life. They take up all our thoughts. They take up our time. The reason many of us go to work and earn a salary so that we can spend money on food and clothing and water. It's to meet our primary needs. So Jesus is not telling us not to worry about silly things. He's telling us not to worry about the fundamental things we need to survive. I also, just to hammer this point home, if you go to any mall, what are most shops selling you? Clothes or food? Go to Walmart Park today after the service and go count how many stores are selling you clothes and how many are selling you food. You'll see it's most of them. These are fundamental human needs. They're things that we think and that consume our time, energy, and money. Also notice in verse, if you guys can just go to the next slide, they summarize the questions, my technical guys. There we go. Notice the questions that we ask. What shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we wear? And let's just compare that to the question Jesus asks. Jesus asks, is life not more than food and the body more than clothing? I think what Jesus is trying to get us to see here and what he's trying to get us to think about is our priorities. Where is your time, your money, your attention, your thoughts focused on? Is it on meeting your needs? Or is it instead on God's kingdom? Seek first his kingdom. Then all these things will be added to you as well. And so, Jesus being typical Jesus, with a simple question, getting us to think, are we spending all our time and our devotion on meeting our own needs? Or are we first seeking God's kingdom and putting his things first? Nonetheless, it's still very difficult not to worry, right? If we're being honest, it's still very difficult not to worry. And if you're a parent, I think it's just compounded because now you've got a little mouth to feed and a little mouth to give clothes to and a little mouth to educate and a little mouth a little body that you might be worried, are they going to make good decisions in life or not? Am I going to raise them to be a good member of society or not? So it's very difficult not to worry about these fundamental needs. So Jesus gives us two very simple illustrations to try and help I see why he says we shouldn't worry. So in verse 25 and verse 26, he speaks about the birds of the air. He says, look at the birds. They don't plan. They don't strive. They don't go to work every morning. Not saying you shouldn't go to work every morning, but they don't have a whole plan of how they're going to feed themselves. Yet God still gives them food. God still provides for their needs. And Jesus asks a question in verse 26. He says, are you, all of you, not much more valuable than they, the birds? We can go to the next slide, by the way, my tech guys, if you don't mind. There we go. Are you not much more valuable than they? Are you not much more valuable than the birds? Every time I read that question, it honestly floors me to think that the creator of the universe, the one who made everything, the one that the kids showed us so beautifully here this morning, all the things God made, to think that he finds you and me valuable. You're worth something to him. This piece of paper, which has my intro on, it's not worth anything to me. I'll tear it without thought. It's not valuable to me. But this 100 rand note, which should be in my pocket, this is valuable to me. I'm not going to tear this thing. I'm sorry, not even for a sermon illustration. I'm keeping this thing. If I have to do a sermon illustration, it's a 10 rand note at most, not the 100 rand. No ways. You're valuable to God. You're precious to him. The other illustration that Jesus gives us is he talks to us about the flowers. Now, in this version, it says flowers. I think there might be a version that speaks about lilies. I'm not sure. But somehow I had lilies in my brain. Maybe it's because lilies are my dad's favorite flower, and he's here today. But God speaks about how beautiful the flowers are. And not even the richest king in the whole Testament was as beautifully clothed as the flowers. My fiance absolutely loves flowers, so every now and then when I'm being a good fiance to her, I go and buy her a bouquet of flowers. How long do you think that bouquet lasts in our house? 2 weeks, 3 weeks if we're lucky. She's got some magic food she uses, and it lasts a bit longer. But something that is so temporary, flowers that last such a short amount of time, yet God has chosen to clothe it more beautifully than even King Solomon. And what question does Jesus ask in verse 30 after giving us this illustration? He says, how much more will he not clothe you, O you of little faith? And there I think is where the two issues are sort of that Jesus is tackling are coming out in these two illustrations. So I want to be practical. I want to try to get you to understand this. So this is when I'm going to ask Duncan, and Duncan, any one of your kids or all of your kids, whoever's feeling brave, just to come up. I've asked Duncan's permission to use him as a sermon illustration. Oh, now we're playing Eeny, Meeny, Miny, Moe. Oh, there we go. Okay. Sorry, Duncan, can I just ask what your daughter's name is? Sophie. Okay, so yes, Duncan and Sophie, right? So, Duncan, I haven't prepped Duncan. I told Duncan he must answer honestly, and I told him, I'm sure he'll say the right thing, but if he doesn't, I'll have to improvise, so we'll see how it goes. Okay, so Duncan is Sophie's father, right? Okay, now, if Sophie comes to you, right, and Sophie's hungry. Sophie, are you hungry right now? Oh, there we go. Sophie's hungry right now. Okay, so Sophie comes up to Duncan, and she's like, yo, Dad, I'm really hungry. Like, I would like something to eat. Whose responsibility is it, yeah, to make sure Sophie gets what she needs, that she gets food to eat? Whose responsibility? Duncan's responsibility. Would you agree with that, Duncan? Okay, so... And if Sophie needs clothes or if she needs to go to school, any of that, whose responsibility ultimately is it to provide? Is it Sophie's or Duncan's? Yeah, Duncan's, the dad's. It's the father's responsibility to provide for his daughter or his child's needs. And then, the flip side, I'm going to just illustrate two things. I'll allow you guys to sit. So that's one thing. Duncan's responsible for providing for Sophie's needs. Okay. Now, Sophie, like, what's your favorite sweet? What's your favorite, like, treat to eat? Sweets, just sweets in general. Yo, any sweet, yeah. Suckers. Okay, so Sophie says she really likes suckers. So now, Sophie, you're super hungry, right? And you go up to your dad and you say, Dad, I'm really hungry. Can you please give me a whole bunch of suckers? And then maybe your dad's kind and gives her some suckers. And then tonight she's hungry again and she comes to you again and she says, Dad, can I please have a whole bunch of suckers? And tomorrow for breakfast and the next day for lunch. Is Duncan being a good father by always saying yes to what Sophie's asking for? No. In fact, Duncan knows what's best for Sophie. Sorry, Sophie. But Duncan knows what's best for Sophie. He's sometimes also going to give her food she may not necessarily want at the time, but he knows that it's best for her. Right? I'm right, Duncan. Okay, cool. Thank you so much, you guys. And go have a seat. You can give them a hand. Okay, so there's two things I'm trying to illustrate here. First thing, I'm going to ask a question to you, and then, guys, you can jump to the next slide once I've asked the next question. Jesus doesn't talk about God as God in this passage. That's not the title he uses. What title does Jesus use twice for God in this passage? Father. Actually, he's more specific. Your Father. Jesus doesn't say my Father. He says your Father. He refers to God twice as your Father. Now, I know we all might have different relationships with our earthly fathers, but that's not what I'm going to focus on today. I'm not talking about our heavenly Father. We all have a heavenly Father. What does it mean that God is your father? Well, number one, it means that you are his child. Duncan came and stood here with his daughter, Sophie. Do you realize that God the Father is your father? That means you are Sophie in the illustration. You are his child. So who's responsible then for meeting your needs? The Father. God the Father. Not you, not your own efforts, your Father. God being your Father means that He is responsible for meeting your needs, not you. It's not on you. But the second thing is there, because I know the objection many of you immediately had in your brain was, yeah, but Josh, there's been those times God hasn't provided what I needed. There's been those times in my life where I've actually lacked, or where I've asked God for something and He didn't give it to me. So let's think about the second thing I illustrated here with Duncan. Does Duncan always give Sophie what she asks for? No. In fact, sometimes Duncan has to choose to say no to what she asks for because he knows what's best. And so the questions that Jesus asks in these two illustrations is firstly, don't you know that you are valuable? In other words, don't you know that you're a child of God, that He cares for you, and He knows that you're responsible for meeting your needs? In fact, in verse 32, it says, your heavenly Father knows that you need them. He knows. So you're valuable and He knows your needs. But secondly, Jesus asks, how much more will He not clothe you, O you of little faith? You see, sometimes when God, especially I'd say when God doesn't provide what you feel like He should, it comes down to your faith. Can you trust that when God says no, it's for your best? I remember in my early 20s, I'm now 26 and nearly 27, so I'm in the later half of my 20s. But in my early 20s, I really, really, really wanted to be married. I didn't want to be married late. My dad was married when we were studying. I thought, I don't want to be that old. I want to be married early 20s. I want to get a wife and done. I didn't enjoy being single, to be honest. sorry, Kaya. he's giving me the look, so he's giving me the look. Okay. So there were many times when a potential someone would come into my life and I'd think, oh, this woman's godly, she's beautiful, like it's going to work out. I really feel like this is the one for me. And then, of course, it wouldn't work out. And I'd end up on my knees in my room. God, why didn't this work out? Why didn't you let this happen? Why did it have to end up this way? I prayed. I really thought you said this was a yes. Now it's a no. And every single time that happened, my faith or my trust in God was put to the test. I can tell you now, as I stand here, 20 days away from being married, I'm really, really glad that God said no all those years. Because I can now see the goodness of God in my life and what He was. And why He was saying no at the time. However, there are also other moments when I look back at prayers that God didn't answer, things I feel God I needed that God didn't provide, that I can't say today I understand why God didn't provide them. In fact, if I had to go back in time, I would have said, God, please, I would have much preferred that God provided what I asked for. In my second year, I had a VW Jetta. The car was, I loved that car. It was older than me, and it was basically my wheels everywhere. It allowed me to get to university. It allowed me to go tutor all my, I did some tutoring to earn some extra money. That car literally, it allowed me to do everything I was doing at the time, second year university student. And then one day, it was a Friday, I was at university the whole day. So at lectures, had a chemistry practical the whole afternoon, finished 5:05, so I was tired. And all I wanted to do was go home, to be honest. I wanted to go home and I wanted to sleep and rest and recover from my busy week. But instead, I went straight from university, didn't go home to a nice warm meal that was waiting for me. I went and picked a whole bunch of guys up and we went to a youth event at Harvest Church, not too far from here, just down the road. And so there I was, seeking God's kingdom first, right? Doing the right Christian thing, putting God's kingdom before my own wants and needs and desires. And when I came out from the youth service, my car wasn't there. It had been stolen. All my university notes in the boot, gone from the semester. My wallet, everything. My means of transport to and from university. The couple of months that followed from that, I have to admit, are some of the most difficult months I ever had in my life. Suddenly, the time that I took to get to university was double. I was spending double the amount of time just trying to get to university, never mind all the work that I still had to catch up. I couldn't get to my tutoring clients to earn my extra money anymore. It was really, really a tough time. And what do you think my prayer was in that time to God? Well, before a while, it was, God, please just bring the car back. Can you please? I mean, I don't even have to understand why. Just please bring the car back. Or please provide me with another means of transportation. But God never did. And looking back, I honestly can't tell you why God never did. I don't have like a positive, I didn't understand then, I understand now. But this is where trust and faith comes in. Because it's easy to trust God when you understand. It's easy to trust God when you have what you need. It's much harder when he hasn't provided something that you really needed and you have to trust that God, I don't know why, but I trust that it's for the best. And God did provide. Like, that's the other thing. God, I mean, my dear grandfather would wake up early in the morning and drive me down to the bus stop so that I could get there. There was still public transport that I could use. Did I like that provision? No. But was it still, did I still get to my classes? Yes. The next year, I got a motorbike. I never, ever thought I'd drive a motorbike. I wasn't interested in them, but it was a means of transportation. So God provided in his own way, and that's the other thing. Sometimes God's provision will not look like what you want it to look like, right? He's not going to give you, like with Duncan, he's not going to give his daughter necessarily the food she always wants, but he will give her the food she needs. Glenn, thank you. Glenn, you said I mustn't quote you, but you had a great line in your sermon last week. So this is a quote from Glenn Charles Weiss. Don't confuse God's ability with his sovereignty, which is very poetic, but let me put it in simpler English words. God is able to provide anything you ask him for, but sometimes he'll choose not to. Can you have not little faith, but a lot of faith, and trust that it is for your best? Okay, I'm going to start drawing to a close now. I don't know if one of the musicians wants to come and make me sound super spiritual. And then can I ask my tech guys if we can get the next slide? So I'm not going to go too much into the details here, but this is actually quite a nice summary of what Jesus' sermon or what Jesus says in these passages of Scripture. And it's quite a nice, there's a pattern to it. There's a name for it and everything. We won't go into that now. But there's a really nice pattern. So Jesus starts and ends his sermon or his message here by saying, do not worry, right? He starts and ends with, do not worry. Then in the first and the last bit of his sermon, he talks about priorities, right? Are you worried about meeting your needs, or are you putting God's kingdom first? Then we talked all about trust in God's provision. He feeds the birds. How much more will he not feed you? He clothes the lilies of the field or the flowers of the field. How much more will he not clothe you? Can you trust in God's provision? But right at the center of what Jesus was speaking about here, still this question, it's the fifth question, the one I haven't addressed yet. Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? Another translation of that same question is, can any one of you, by worrying, add a single cubit to your height? Cubit's a couple of centimeters. I know some of you would love to say yes to that, but you can't. And when I was looking at this, I really had a wonder, like, Jesus, why did you put that question at the center? Everything else seems so important, like put God's kingdom first, trust in his provision. Why would he put such a simple question that has an obvious answer? What's the obvious answer? No. It's such a, why would he put that at the center? And when I was thinking about this, I think God just hit me and he said, it's the key to understanding everything that I'm saying. And I realized, well, at least for myself, it made sense. I always thought that was just a throwaway sentence, Jesus just being extra, you know, giving us bonus material. But then I realized, no, he's actually trying to tell us something really important. Because when you answer that question honestly, what it makes you realize is you're not in control. All your worries, all your efforts, all your striving, you can't even add a single second onto the day. You're not in control. I'm not in control. I think so many of our worries stem from the fact that we feel like we are in control. That it's on us, that it's our responsibility. This question helps us realize that we're not in control, which can be scary until you realize we know the one who is. In fact, the one who is in control is our Father, who loves us dearly, and we can trust him. I'm going to end with this quote. It's quite a lengthy quote. So I went on, you might have heard of it before, this camp or this course called Journey to Fullness. Highly recommend it. And we were there on the one night. It wasn't even part of the course. This was honestly what happened. This quote that I'm going to read to you was bonus material. We were just chatting the one night with the facilitators, just hanging out. And one of the facilitators, Gary, said this, and I really try to capture what he said as accurately as possible. Gary, if you ever listen to this, I'm sorry if I didn't get your words perfectly. But when he said this, it just absolutely like whacked me in the face, and it's been sitting with me ever since. So this is what Gary said. He said, too many Christians, that's us, too many Christians, are committed to God. They're committed to go to church on a Sunday or to prayer meeting in the week or to read their Bible every morning. They're very happy being committed, willing to give God part of their time, part of their money, part of their life. God doesn't want our commitment. He wants our surrender. Surrender means nothing belongs to me anymore. My time, my money, my energy, my resources, my car, my house, my wife, my children, all belong to God. It is all His and there to be used for His kingdom. When we're able to surrender, to recognize that everything actually belongs to God and to give it over to Him, when we realize we're not in control of any of it, that is when we're able to let go of worry and anxiety and realize that nothing rests on our shoulders, but everything rests in the hand of a God who made us, who loves us, who cares for us, who values us, who knows what we need before we even ask. Are you willing to surrender to God today? To give Him all those things you've been holding on to and say, Lord, it's yours. We sang that song a few weeks ago in church, I surrender all. Do we surrender it all to Him? Do we give it all to Him? Let's bow our heads and pray. And as you just maybe bow your head there, just think for a moment. Before I even start praying to God, just in your own time, in your own way, just maybe have a quick chat with God. Look into your heart. Think about, is there something I'm holding on to? Something I think that my efforts can change? Something that I'm trying to control? Is it perhaps time to give it to Him? To surrender it to Him? To recognize that He cares for you? To have the faith in Him to provide for your needs? Maybe not in the way that you're hoping for, but in the way that you truly need. In the way that He knows is best for you. Father God, we owe it all to You. You gave it all for us, but we owe everything to You. Everything I have, everything we are, it all belongs to You. Would You please help us not to hang on to those things, not to try and control, but to realize that You are in total control. Father, where there's a lack of faith, Glenn preached about this last week, but where there's a lack of faith, where there's a lack of belief in Your ability or in Your goodness, or in Your willingness to provide, would You increase faith? Would You help people to trust in You? Would You help them to see that You are a good Father and that they can rely on You, they can rest on You? I thank You for these beautiful words, Jesus. Do not worry. And I thank You that You make them possible, that by ourselves is not possible not to worry, but because we can rely and have faith in You, it is possible not to worry. It is possible to walk through life on a firm foundation, that though there's wind and rage, a raging sea and a storm around us, we can set our eyes on You, Jesus, and on our Father in heaven who cares for us, and we can walk firmly. I just pray that this really sinks and rests on people's hearts. I pray that it rests on my heart, that when I am facing a lack of anything, that I am able to turn to You and know that You know about my need. Would You help me to put Your kingdom first and to rely on You to meet my needs? I thank You for all these things, Jesus. Amen.